Good morning and welcome to First Christian Church. I want to start us out with just a few announcements, just to mention a few things for folks that are watching online at their homes and also those of us in the sanctuary. We want to lift up in prayer the family of Bobby Darnell, who we had his funeral service yesterday, and Eddie Height served as one of the honorary pallbearers as we were remembering his service as part of the firefighting force here in Salem. Also want to mention about Booty Mills, who has been moved over to the Oaks and is going to be over there for respite care for the next month. So continue prayers for her and for her family. Also had a chance to speak with Jean and find out that Lina Prilliman had broken her leg. She got thrown off a horse, and she broke it in two places, kind of a compound fracture. So she had to have a surgery to get things set right, and now she's waiting on a cast. And so just prayers for Lina, the Prillimans, and just as she's in the process of recovering. We also had a funeral service this past week for Barbara Glass, Becky Ayers' mother, and so continued prayers for Becky Ayers and Justin and that family. Let me mention a few other things of interest in the life of our church family. We are going to be doing a mission trip, as we have for many years, over spring break, and we want everyone to support and encourage our young people as they head off on this trip. This year's mission is going to be a little different than past years. We're going to be staying at a church camp, and so we're not going to be traveling in and around the community like we've done in years past because of COVID concerns. So we'll be on site at this camp, self-contained during the week. But that also means that we're going to be providing our own food this year, and we're going to be asking for a little bit of help from the church as we're fundraising to get ready for this week. Let me mention two ways you can do that. Let me mention three. First thing you could do is sponsor one of our young people. We do have two of our younger youth that are going to probably needs a little bit of financial help. So you could choose to write a check and sponsor one of the kids for the trip, and we'd be thrilled if you wanted to do that. We're also going to be having a car wash over at Advanced Auto Parts, and that's going to be happening on March the 20th, which is a Saturday. And so you can come by and get your car washed and make a donation to our outreach. And then also on March the 21st, which is 2 weeks from this Sunday morning, we're going to be providing a box lunch, and we're going to be taking orders. So starting next Sunday, there's going to be an insert in the bulletin, and you can fill out a reservation for one or two or three or four box lunches. And what we're going to do is we're going to have those lunches ready. When you leave worship, you're going to just go out the door, jump in your car, and you can drive right around to the back, and we're going to put it in your vehicle, and off you go. So that'll be 2 weeks from now. We're going to be providing that for a donation, a takeout box lunch, which is going to be a hot dog, chili, chips, Little Debbie box lunch. Also want to mention this evening is going to be our board meeting. So if you're a member of the board, 7 o'clock board meeting, we'll be providing a Zoom link for that if you can't come in person, but we will be having an in-person board meeting with masks and social distancing. Wednesday night services have been going great. Our worship series, which is kind of getting us ready for Easter, has been very interesting, and we've had just a great turnout during these Wednesday nights. 6 o'clock meal, and then 6:30 we're in here in the sanctuary for a video lesson on the front screen. And I did want to give a quick shout out to Warren Ori for making chili for us 2 weeks ago, which I missed dinner, but then he had a takeout bowl for me, which I took home and enjoyed. And also this past Sunday, Amanda Gray was our cook, and she provided a very nice meal for us. So thanks to Amanda for doing that. We're so glad to see everyone this morning. Let's worship together.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made.
Will you join with Kay and I in the call to worship? We come to church to learn the ways of God.
We come to church to act on the teachings of Christ.
We come to church to share the joy of following Jesus.
We come to church to let the Holy Spirit guide and direct us.
We come to church to worship.
And we come to church to praise God in song. And so our opening hymn today is Blessed Assurance. In the chorus it goes, this is my story, this is my song.
Amen.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, always at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Would you pray with me? Dear Lord, on this beautiful Sunday morning, we come together in this sanctuary to recognize how awesome and almighty you are. Lord, today is a bit of a milestone as we come to you, because Lord, it's been a year that we mark that we've been in the midst of this trying and turbulent pandemic. 1 year ago, we were in this sanctuary, Lord, and we were having a worship service, and then we left and everything changed. But Lord, we recognize that you knew that because you are awesome and almighty. So God, you know the future. You know what's in front of all of us. And today as we pray to you, we recognize our need to look to you for guidance. Since you are the God who is walking with us and ahead of us, please guide and direct our footsteps, Lord. Help us to be the people you need us to be. Encourage and fill us with a sense of your wonder and love. Lord, we also come to you with our prayers. We look to you as the Lord of our lives and ask prayers for people we love and care about. A family member we know who is facing some challenging, traumatic situation. Maybe it's a health concern. Maybe it's a concern with their job. Maybe it's someone who has a concern about a family issue or relation. Lord, as we pray to you, we find our minds thinking about people we love and care about. And then, Lord, we pray that you would hear these prayers of our hearts. Please, Lord, be with the people we care about and love and help them along as you've helped us. And bring people into their lives that can help and guide and direct their footsteps as we ask the same for ourselves. So, Lord, we pray for the people we care about. Lord, we also take time as we come to you before you in prayer to ask that you would guide and direct the footsteps of our nation. We are a diverse community of people, and yet within our fine nation, there are so many wonderful, good people that strive every day to guide and direct our communities. So, Lord, prayers for our leaders, prayers for our community leaders and our national leaders. And Lord, we also continue as we pray to ask for prayers for our world. We live in this big, huge world, and yet we are one family of God. So Lord, be the Father of all of our world community. So Lord, we pray for those we care about. We pray for our world and our community. We finally, Lord, we also take time to pray during this special season of Lent as we think about Jesus and the sacrifices that he made to bring us into this sanctuary today. His compassion and love for disenfranchised people, his empathy and caring for children and women and folks that were somehow usually cast aside in their society. Lord, help us to be like Christ. Help us to think on his teachings. Help us, Lord, to live lives that are centered on his love. And help us, Lord, to walk out of today's worship experience with deeper hearts and caring for those around us. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus taught us a prayer to pray, and we've prayed this prayer every Sunday that we're in worship. Would you join with me in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Many things about tomorrow. I
Good morning. I have in my hand a picture from a Bible story, and it makes me really wonder what's going on here. This picture, can you see it? This picture is a picture of Jesus, and he's in the temple, sort of like our church. And he looks very angry. And he has this table in his hands, and he's turning that table over, and coins and money is going everywhere. And it makes me wonder what it is that would have Jesus so upset. Well, what was happening in this story is Jesus went to the temple to worship. And in the temple, there were animals, there were cattle, and there are these doves. And there were people that were exchanging money. He wasn't mad that they were there. That didn't make him mad at all. But there was something going on here with these money changers and people selling animals that upset Jesus. And it was sort of like this. Let's say we were going to go to the grocery store. We had no food, and we really needed some groceries. So when we went to the grocery store, we have to use a bag like this to buy our groceries. All right? So pretend that we have to use a bag just like this. If we don't use a bag like this, we can't buy any groceries. Okay, this bag should cost maybe 5 cents. And I'm willing to pay my nickel to get that bag so I can get my groceries. But what if, because they knew I had to buy this bag, they said, nope, I want $5 for it. Well, $5 is a lot more than 5 cents. And that's not fair, but I would have to give them my $5 so I could buy my groceries. That's not fair at all, is it? Well, that's the kind of thing that was happening in the temple that day. They were charging people extra money to be able to go there and do the kind of worship they were supposed to do. And it made Jesus very unhappy. So, what was Jesus really unhappy about? He was unhappy because people were treating other people unfairly. He was taking advantage of them, and they weren't being kind to each other. He wants us to be kind to each other and love each other and to be generous with each other. That word generous means maybe they could sell me this bag for 3 cents instead of 5 cents. That would be even better, wouldn't it? Okay. Would you pray with me, please? Loving God, we thank you for Jesus.
He wants so much
for us to be kind and loving. Please help us to find space in our hearts.
To find space in our hearts.
To really love people.
To really love people.
Amen.
Amen.
Good morning. Our scripture this morning is from the book of John, chapter 2, verses 13 through 22. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. May God bless the reading of his word.
Have you ever been in one of those situations where someone in the household all of a sudden just flies off the handle? And it seems like, where did that come from? Like, what's going on here? Has that ever happened in your household? I see whispering. I see people looking at one another. Of course, that's never, you know, it's never me. Uh-huh. You know, the disciples and Jesus are heading off to the temple today, and it's like kind of a, it's like a great day. They've come into Jerusalem, and it's business as usual into church. And there's nothing here to get upset about. There really isn't. And yet, we have in Scripture this story of Jesus flying off the handle. We have in our archive in the church office, Jesus movies. And I personally always am intrigued by the scene of any Jesus movie of Jesus turning over the tables in the temple. Because you always want to see how Hollywood's going to betray this. And I've seen Jesus movies where you're literally scared of Jesus. You're like, oh, wow, he's really losing it. Look at him. He's yelling and screaming and kicking stuff. And we almost can't imagine Jesus just flying off the handle. We can't even kind of get it in our imaginations. And we figure to ourselves, if Jesus is going to get really upset, he's going to yell and scream, we best have a pretty good idea why. And you know, that's kind of where we are today. The sermon's going to be, well, let's figure out why Jesus got so upset. And if we can maybe get a handle on that, then we can see maybe a pretty good idea of something that really we want to make sure we avoid, because apparently it really makes Jesus upset. Well, in order to do that, we probably have to think a little bit about the process. Let's just think about the process of worship. You show up for worship, and the Jews would come to worship. They'd come to the temple, and they would do that pretty frequently. So it wasn't, you know, surprising that they went to temple with Jesus, to the temple. It was something that happened frequently, except once a year, like we would have Christmas, and everyone might come, really want to make an emphasis to come to Christmas Eve service. Once a year, the Jews, everyone tried to show up at temple about the same time. And this was a special festival. And so everyone's showing up. So it's just like normal church, but just times five. So maybe a little more chaos. Part of the process of coming to temple is to bring a sacrifice. And historically, the way this sacrifice would work is that you're supposed to bring some cherished sacrifice with you. And so in the case of, you know, the netting household, we might choose one of the lambs that we have been raising, and we're going to bring that lamb to temple on this special festival day for sacrifice. So I'm going to say to Kira, Kira, can you go out back and can you get Lammy and can you bring Lammy along? We got to go. And so we're going to be walking to, you know, a day's journey or longer, and we're staying with friends in Jerusalem, and Kira has been given responsibility of bringing Lammy along. And we're walking, and Kira's bored, and we've been on the road, and she's, you know, this lamb's not very big, so she's going to, you know, look at this thing, and she's going to just pick up Lammy, because Lammy's kind of small, and she's just carrying this thing. And I know Kira, so she's just, you know, bored, petting, nice Lammy, good Lammy. And I'm looking back at Kira, and I'm saying, Kira, stop petting Lammy. And by the way, the Lammy is not named Lammy. Don't name it Lammy. What, Lammy? No, that's a good name. And I'm thinking, oh, no, this is not going well, right? Because Lammy is going to have a short lifey, and that's going to result in a whole lot of tears out of Kira. So this is how it's going to go down. We're going up the temple, and I'm going to be like, Kira, I need Lammy. And she's going to be like, yeah. And I'm going to be like, oh, my word, what were we thinking? And, you know, it all seems really sad, doesn't it? And, you know, you're going to take this little lamb, and then you're going to present it to the priest, and this is going to get messy, and Kira's going to cry, and Paige is going to be, like, on Kira's side, and then Allison's going to look at me like, did you really, you know, really? Did you think this is going to go well? And Christmas is just, right? It's just like, nah. So, you know, that's a problem. And when there's problems, we as humans, we seek to solve these sorts of problems. And so the entrepreneurial Jewish person says, I have a solution to your problem, Dan Netting. And so when we arrive at temple, because, you know, we're traveling and we're staying with friends, and all we have to do is to show up with some shekels, and we can buy a dove, we can purchase a lamb. You know, things are getting a little bit more convenient for us. And so then we can pay, and then we can have this lamb sacrificed. And so, you know, one of the first things that I think Jesus really got upset about, and this is so weird for us to imagine, but he was upset about convenience. He's like Mr. Anti-Convenience. And who can imagine? You would think Jesus would want to accommodate us on this beautiful Sunday morning. When I was a kid, one of the really cool things that happened in my life as a Boy Scout, our Boy Scout troop took a trip to Washington, D.C., and I got to go into the Aerospace Museum, and I thought it was the coolest thing ever. Huge rocket ships, things that landed on the moon or should have landed on the moon. Sputnik, famous airplanes. I love that place. I got lost in that place. It was just so amazing. And so I'm coming, my girls are coming into the same age when I had this opportunity, and I announced to Paige and Kira, my daughters, good news, we're going to Washington, D.C., and I'm going to take you to the ultimate museum of all time. We're going to the Aerospace Museum. I get my daughters in there, and they're like, it's a plane. It's a rocket ship. I'm hungry. Let's go get some lunch. And I'm like, oh, why? What was I thinking? These girls who were supposed to just be wide-eyed and amazed, but they were looking for lunch. So I said, well, you know, we can't, you know, that's not what we're here for. We're here, you know, to do other things and look at this museum stuff. And the girls weren't impressed. And we're walking way down at one end of the museum. And I realized that the Aerospace Museum had built an entire wing that I wasn't there when I was a boy. And this entire wing housed this huge cafeteria, which was the world's biggest McDonald's. And my daughters were like, whoa! They were so excited. And so this was before Allison, and that's a whole other story about Allison and food and Paige and food. We'll get into that later. But right now, let's just say we went there, and we got to this place where there's people everywhere, and we got in line, and we ordered, you know, a number two, and we got our burger, we got our fries, and it set me back like $20, right? Because we're at the Smithsonian Institute. And I'm like, oh my word. And this is when I'm turning into the Jesus guy. I'm looking around and I'm thinking, this whole place is one big ripoff. Like this food, it's just a burger. It's just McDonald's. And I'm getting ripped off. And my kids are chowing down on fries when they should be looking at spaceships. And this whole thing has just gone wrong. And there's no one in the cafeteria who's upset. There's no one around everyone is thrilled, except for Dan Netting, except for Jesus. No one else, everyone's like, look, you knew, we provide you with a hot meal. Your kids are hungry. They're no longer crying. They're happy. So it cost you twice what it should have cost you. It doesn't matter. You made that choice. You are sitting here. You're part of the problem. So be quiet. And I did be quiet. But Jesus just couldn't be quiet. He just couldn't take it anymore. He said, you know what? Maybe it would be good for you to wander around the Smithsonian Institute and look at huge rocket ships hungry. Maybe it'd be good for you. Maybe it'd build a little character in you. Someone had figured out how to turn the Smithsonian Institute into a cafeteria. 2 years later, we went to the Natural History Museum. And, you know, I'm looking over at Lauren. I forgot. Lauren did an internship at the Smithsonian. She knows all about this stuff, which is an amazing, we could get her up to tell us about that. But we went there, and Lauren knows this is true. I used to go, I love the IMAX. I love the IMAX. It's the coolest thing ever. It's just huge, amazing experience. And I'm at the Natural History Museum. I want to take my kids to the IMAX to see some kind of natural, beautiful thing. And I go to buy my ticket, and there is no ticket to buy because where there was an IMAX, they took that out. And you know what they built? Another cafeteria. So I'm like, what? Not only do we have a cafeteria in the middle of this beautiful museum, but we took out this amazing theater that could have changed people's lives forever. For what? In the name of a hamburger and fries. And I was just, again, just being mad about that while we went through the line and got a hamburger and fries, right? Part of the problem. The Jewish people and Jesus' disciples, they looked at Jesus and they said, they're not doing a bad thing. They're doing a good thing. They are providing a service that allows people to worship. They are providing animals that allows people to sacrifice. They are taking money that has the image of Caesar on it, and they're exchanging it for temple currency that doesn't. Everyone is doing what they're supposed to do. And meanwhile, Jesus is like, oh, I'm sick of it. Jesus got mad over convenience. Because we better learn that sometimes following in the ways of the awesome and almighty God is going to be inconvenient. Completely inconvenient. So then Jesus, in a fit, he knocks over the table, and all the money goes flying. And I'm going to speculate that he didn't help to pick up the dollars and the coins. I'm going to just speculate. I don't know that. It doesn't say in the scripture. I bet he didn't. And, you know, there's money everywhere, and it's chaos, and all of a sudden someone's like, well, who is this guy? What's his authority? He needs to show us his ID. Who are you to take this whole system where all these people are coming to church and disrupt it? And, you know, I get thinking about when I decided I wanted to take, like, my Jesus thing to the next level. You know, it was like casual Christian, next level. And you know what next level was? It was one big, huge disruption to my entire life. It was leave the job where you are working. It was travel to a foreign land called Kentucky. It was re-enroll in class and start to figure out how to study the Bible. It was make a financial investment. It was a huge disruption. Jesus kicked over tables because he wanted everyone to look up and go, well, this is inconvenient. This is making us slow down. We were hoping to get out of temple this morning in time for lunch, and now what's happened? Have you got to the point maybe in your spiritual life where it's convenient and it doesn't get disrupted? It's a system. You follow the system. You do your thing. You show up on a Sunday morning. You sit. You worship. You get on with it. And on it goes. And Jesus says, I want to make this something that doesn't flow so easy. I want it to be a mess. We had the chance to go to Las Vegas, my family, and we got there. We were kind of on a low budget, so we had to go in the middle of the summer when the rates were low. And when we got to Las Vegas, it was 114 degrees. Whew. But, you know, no worries. We were staying in a hotel that had a pool. Yay. So my girls are like, this is great. We're going to go to the pool. We went down to the pool. It had a lazy river. We got in the lazy river. We lazy rivered in 114 degrees and said, oh, that was fun. Let's do it again and again and again. Let's just do loops in the lazy river. But we couldn't because the whistle blew. Get out of the pool. And we're like, what happened? Well, you know what happened. It always happens. Someone had a little accident, you know, get out of the pool, kind of have to hyperchlorinate the water for an hour, and all of a sudden, you know, this system was broken, and we had to cook on the deck at 114 degrees for an hour, right? Not so much fun. Disruptive. It ruined everything. No, it doesn't. You know, God doesn't want it to be simple, and God doesn't want it to be just easy. I can tell you, when I got back in the lazy river after an hour, I really appreciated it so much more. So Jesus is upset about convenience. He's upset and wants to disrupt the system. And then finally, he's upset about what Kay mentioned for our children this morning. He's upset about exploitation of individuals. You know, if you have the means, then you can deliver your lamb to temple without too much worry. Because you don't have Kira carrying and guiding Lammy. You just have the servants handling that stuff. You've got people that can get the animal there. But if you are a poor person, if you are a disenfranchised person, if it's all you can do to afford to get your family to temple, then you're the one that's going to have to purchase the dove. And you're the one that's going to take the 5-cent dove and pay $5 for it. And Jesus just couldn't stand it. We take advantage of the very least of these. We exploit the people who don't have the means to be exploited. And so that was what finally put him over the edge. People ripping someone off right in the middle of church. He couldn't stand it. You take in this place, it's supposed to be an equitable place where everyone gets to worship, and you've turned it into a den of thieves. You've turned it into a place where people make money and they don't even care who you are. Hey, we don't have any funds. Can we just have a dub? No. I'm here to make money. Are you really? Are you here to allow people to have a worship experience? So Jesus gets upset and gets angry. He's tired. He's given his life for who? The very least of these. And here we are in a place we call church and doing the same thing. Jesus said to the folks that day, said, you know what? This place is going to be torn down. It's going to be gone. And when it's gone, I'll build it back in 3 days. And they were like, okay, you're crazy. That is not a true statement. It took 46 years to build this place. And Jesus, as we all know, is referring to the fact that the temple becomes you, and it becomes you, becomes me. We are the temple. And you know what? If you're the temple, And if Jesus is what he's saying is true, I will become a living temple, then you know what? All this stuff that's getting knocked over and kicked out and washed out in the temple, that stuff has to get washed out in you because you're the temple now. You think about yourself. Do you have tendencies to exploit people in your life? Do you have tendencies to take advantage of people who are just doing the right thing, being kind and generous? Do you take the time to appreciate the people who help you out? Do you look at your wife, your husband, as just someone that's there to get the dishes done? Are they truly someone you should appreciate? Do you look at your kids and think what a privilege it is to have children? Do you look at your grandkids and try and truly appreciate them as children of the living God? Do you have some issues there where you're exploiting? Yes, you do. And do I? Yes, I do. So is Jesus a little upset about that? Absolutely. Okay, Jesus, okay. Get your stuff together, Dan. Okay. Clean me out a little bit. Do you think that maybe it's time that Jesus disrupts your life a little bit? Makes things a little bit inconvenient for you? Do you think that maybe you've fallen into a pattern of just kind of doing the very minimum you got to do to call yourself a Christian? And you know what? When Jesus disrupts your life, are you going to get mad and say, I can't believe that we've got illness. I can't believe that we're struggling financially. This is terrible. Or are we going to lean into some disruption and go, Lord, let me pray to you. Let me cling to you. I need your guidance. Are you going to just get mad at Jesus? Are you going to let him realize that he loves you? Sometimes when we love people, we say, get your act together. And I think that's what Jesus is doing for everyone in that temple. And that's what he's going to be doing for us today, is we are that temple. He's going to come in. He's going to knock a few things over. And he's going to try and clean a few things out in our lives. And you know, we need it. We all need that. Jesus is not only going to knock over tables and get a little upset, but you know, the final thing about Jesus, the reason we're all here, is he lives it. He doesn't just say words. He puts his words into action with his life. And it's time that we do the same thing. Not just words, but recognizing Jesus said, I will be with you. And he was there. And he is now the living temple. So let's live our lives centered on the ideals that he raised his voice for today. And let's make sure that we are the ones that are giving the very least of these the equitable treatment that they deserve. Amen. Well, visitors and guests, we have some visitors today. Super exciting. And let's talk about a visitor. Well, what about communion? I'm not a member of this church, or I've never been to this church, or I'm not sure about my relationship with Jesus. Well, if Jesus is here, he's inviting everyone to this table. We know that because that's what he did in the Bible. He invited everyone to the table. So you're a visitor, you're a guest, you're in a process of learning more about your faith and your relationship with Jesus. This is your table. You're invited. Historically, we would take the lid off this tray. We would walk out and we would serve you and say, here, have this piece of bread, have this cup. We're not doing that because of COVID, but I look forward to the day when we once again say to everyone, here, I'm serving you this bread. I'm serving you this cup. We have, at the moment, run out of bread and cup to give, but we will be doing that. But of course, we also encourage everyone to bring their own bread and cup. So let us commune together.
Let us pray. Lord, as we take this bread, we remember that you are the bread of life. You feed our souls, you nourish our hearts, and you give us sustenance to walk this road we call life. As we break the bread, we feel the softness of your love for us. We thank you with all our hearts for the great price you paid when you were crucified on the cross for us. Yet, just as the yeast has caused this bread to rise, you rose again, triumphant over death as Lord of lords and King of kings forever, and our beloved Savior. Amen.
Amen. these words from Scripture. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and blessed it and said, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
Let us pray. Lord, as we drink this wine, we remember that you are the giver of life. You are forgiveness. You bring deep peace to our souls, and your love flows within us. As we pour out this wine, we see your sacrifice poured out for us. We notice the depth of your goodness and the pain you suffered for us. We dwell upon the intricacy of life, of human life, and the price you paid to set humanity free. Yet, just as the tombstone rolled away to unleash the risen Lord, your light shines in our hearts now, extinguishing all darkness to release heaven's blessings upon us. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Amen. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Let me just mention about our offering. First of all, thank you for your continued financial support for the ministry of First Christian Church. And then let's just mention about how closely tied our offering is to our offering, right? Because today is this amazing story about coming to temple, and the process of coming to temple was to come to temple and to bring your sacrifice and to offer that to God. And what we do all these years later is we come to church and we bring our sacrifice and we offer it to God. And our sacrifice is our offering. It is our tithes and offerings, because it's hard to give money because we need it for so many things, right? It's the universal ability to have the mechanism to buy the things we need. So every time when we write a check, we do that in faith. And it's an amazing process of saying, God, I trust in you, and I trust in the ability of this church to take my tithes and offerings and be able to do the work of God in this world through that. So thank you for your support, and let's hope that we can continue to financially support our churches as we try and go forward and share this good news. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Our closing hymn, I Give My Life for Thee.
I give my life for thee, my precious blood I shed, that thou might ransom me and quicken from the dead. I gave my life for thee. What hast thou given for me? I gave my life for thee. What hast thou given for me? And I have brought to thee, down from my home above, salvation full and free, my pardon and my love. I bring rich gifts to thee. What hast thou brought to me? I bring rich gifts to thee. What hast thou brought to me?
Aaron Armistead's going to bring our benediction today.
Will you pray with me? Dear God, thank you for letting us all gather here together this morning. And thank you for the beautiful sunshine and blue skies. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We close with the Spirit song.
Oh, let the Son of God enfold you with His Spirit and His love. Let Him fill your heart and satisfy your soul. Oh, let Him have the things that hold you, and His Spirit like a dove will descend upon your life and make you whole.